It is such a pleasure to be here tonight, and as we come in, each of us, to hear from our mayor of the State of the City address, and I'm just having a small role in just talking about an endeavor that the mayor and I have been working on. One of the first things that conversations that I had with Mayor Jones after his initial election as mayor of the City of Richmond was concerning helping us to elevate the Slave Trail Commission's project to another level. And since that time, Mayor Jones has exhibited true excellence in a number of areas. As a business-savvy mayor, he's been very instrumental in improving conditions for our most disadvantaged and impoverished communities, as well as being a key facilitator of economic development in this city, making this city a better place for all of us to live and to work and to play. I was particularly proud of Mayor Jones and this city when I saw a piece on Today's Show showcasing Richmond, Virginia as one of the best places to travel in 2016. And so before they show this video, I just come tonight also to say to Mayor Jones, who has successfully lent his voice, his commitment and resources in bringing the goals of Richmond Speak and the Slave Trail to the forefront. Mayor Jones, wherever you are, thank you for your leadership in creating a better Richmond for all of us. And so tonight we want to share with you just a little about Richmond Speak. And as the video is played.
For many years, we've watched as an incomplete history has been told in our country. So many of us, for so many years, have watched that incomplete history unfold. We've watched our history swept under the rug. We've watched our history pushed aside. We've watched our history be overlooked. But now we have brought the wonderful opportunity tonight. We have an opportunity to bring honor to our ancestors and to bring justice to those who deserve to be recognized, who have heretofore perhaps not been recognized as they could have been. Now, we've had some victories and we fought some battles, but all of us will agree that our story has not fully been told. And tonight we're here because now we have the opportunity to tell a more complete story. And so the truth of the matter is that the process we've started tonight, Richmond Speaks, goes directly to the heart of that history, to our history right here in the city of Richmond. These discussions are important because we have to understand that the way we build the Lumpkin site is going to change how we tell our story.
As a father, I guess, looking into the future, yes, I can actually tell my children or even my grandchildren that when this whole thing comes to fruition, that I was able to contribute.
I am a descendant of that Dr. James H. Holmes, but he was actually one of the freed men that came out of Lumpkin's jail. So to be able to, again, to preserve the heritage of Lumpkin's jail and be able to share that with not just the locals here, but take that internationally, I think is going to be a pivotal point in our history.
St. John's Church on the top of the hill is give me freedom or give me death, and all of the freedoms associated with that, and just below it in Chapel Bottom, is the opposite of the freedom in St. John's Church. So using that as a marketing piece might heighten the site as an international site.
There was a lot of talk about wanting to get children involved, both incorporating it more into curriculums and also creating sort of activities around the site.
I went to Jamestown about 2 times in elementary school. I've never learned anything down here. I never went to the slave trail. I never did this. And when I drive by, I just be like, oh, it's just something on the wall. I want it to grow so it can be better. Oh, I'm about to cry.
We should actually reconstruct the jail so people can touch it and get a feel, because a museum can be a cold place.
And knowing where it started and where it is now will probably grasp a lot of attention from a lot of students.
Are we prepared to equalize education so black children get to learn about their rich history as well, because it's not just, you know, the little part that we got when we went to school. Mm-hmm. So tell the truth. I mean, but the truth does hurt. Some people, it bothers them. I'm the type to also try to, you know, help them along to understand, like, now what do we do?
It could be a forerunner in reconciliation, everyone coming together, perhaps through a reconciliation conference or festival once a year.
My name is Cynthia Newhill, and I have the pleasure and honor of serving as the City Council representative for the 7th District East End community. Tonight has been tremendous because it has afforded the citizenry of the City of Richmond to let their voices be heard, to bring their ideas, their suggestions.
I'm going to think positive and hope that City Council and the mayor and all the other folks will really and truly incorporate some of what the community would like to see done into the actual final plan.
Thinking about the Black History Museum, thinking about the Civil War Museum, how do we sort of bring this into the larger picture?
Good evening, everyone. I'm Tasha Chambers, and I am the new museum director for the Black History Museum.
So it was great to see the mayor involved, which is always a plus. And I'm also Delegate McQuinn here and being vocal and always being a constant advocate in this initiative. I think it's also important not to just harbor on the dark past of slavery, but to make sure that we're talking about the achievements and the resiliency of African Americans from post-Civil War and where we are today.
There is a broader history event that included self-liberation. Self-determination, the resistance that was is partly through Paul Pulver's jail site, but needs to be more broadly interpreted.
Slaves are not an image. They are a state of somebody being oppressed. So I think we need to make sure that is reinforced.
Looking at the allocation of funding. And keeping our eye on the ball, we know that our resources are limited, our funds are limited, but we have to get this done now, get it off the ground, then we can build on that.
Africans being enslaved here and abroad, that message has to be sent out so that we can reconciliate ourselves and become a true nation for one another. And that's just my take. I'm just thankful.
You know, you find a lot of local leaders in a lot of neighborhoods, and all those people is making very strong efforts. It makes you change your vision about Richmond.
One consensus that we came to is the hope that the Lumpkins jail site is simply a start, you know, simply the beginning.
The story in my family is that we are descended from George Rogers Clark. And when Gabriel's Rebellion happened, and Gabriel's wife was bought by Rogers Clark and taken to a plantation in Kentucky. Well, when a historian from Virginia State University, who is Gabriel's great-great-great-great-grandson, related that story. So basically, he was this man telling me that my great-great-grandfather, or who I think was my great-great-great-great-grandfather, might have bought his great-great-great-great-grandmother. I think a proper memorialization of the slave trade and putting it in its proper place as a mistake in the past that shouldn't be repeated again, I think that would be something personally gratifying to me, given what we think our family's history is.
The truth about it, a lot of us are not going to be around 25 years, 30 years, whatever. And if we don't get it right in terms of helping to tell this story and being collaborating to get it told, then guess what? We have did another disservice. We've done to our ancestors, and then we have done disservice to the future generations who are coming. So I just wanted to say that it's not just this one thing. It's just one of many things that need to be done.
And just now you had a little insight in terms of what Richmond Speaks is all about. And so in the words of Governor Robert McDonald, and as the mayor and I went to visit him to get resources to address this particular issue and to do something, build something at Lumpkins Jail, It's one of the best things I did as governor, he said. It is a place that we must be preserved and remembered to teach lessons to future generations to make a better America. And I'm so pleased to know that we had a mayor right here in the city of Richmond who has done an excellent job, extraordinary job, in helping to make sure that Richmond speaks and that we'll do something on that particular site and on the slave trail. Thank you again, Mayor Jones.
Good evening, and welcome to the State of the City Address. My name is Khadijah Baker, and I'm the 2015-2016 Youth Mayor. I am also a senior at Thomas Jefferson High School. This evening, I have the honor of introducing the Honorable Dwight C. Jones, Mayor of my great city. Before I invite Mayor Jones to the lectern, I would like to say, under Mayor Jones, the state of the Academy has been strong. Under Mayor Jones's leadership, the Mayor's Youth Academy Future Leaders Program has championed many issues that impact youth in the city, such as Chromebook Project, giving youth who do not have access to home computers additional technological devices at public libraries to complete homework assignments. This project was instrumental in allowing youth the ability to use computers beyond the 1 hour time restriction to complete assignments without disruptions. We Are One Project. This endeavor is the beginning for teens in our great city to have healthy interactions with our law enforcement community and will be instrumental in continuing to foster the existing and amazing relationship we share with the Richmond Police Department. The Academy has not only given us a voice, but has enabled us to be a part of the solution. As many of you know, the Future Leaders Program is only one aspect of the Academy. The impact of the Academy has been the summer work experience component. Under Mayor Jones's leadership, the Academy has engaged over 3,000 youth with meaningful work experience opportunities in a multitude of career fields. My journey with NYA began with the life stage portion. Now I have had the privilege of being part of the summer work experience, which has provided me with an invaluable amount of real-world experience. Not only have I obtained real-life job readiness skills and leadership development, I have also been able to experience civic engagement, community service, mentoring, and exposure to post-secondary educational options. Oh yeah, how could I forget? We are also fortunate to receive an incentive while improving our quality of life. In closing, on behalf of all Richmond City youth, thank you, Mayor Jones, for all you have done and will continue to do for us. And after a brief video, it is my honor to welcome our mayor to the podium, the Honorable Dwight C. Jones.
An equal opportunity,
quality of life,
community
transformation,
education,
multi-generational effort,
regional cooperation,
transportation,
jobs,
investment,
community
partnership,
small businesses,
history.
You know, Richmond's a great city.
And it's because this city is changing, it is coming alive, it is growing.
Richmond is just taking off like a rocket.
Dwight Jones, I'm a big fan of his. He really gets it in terms of economic development and really what drives the economy.
Mayor, it is great to be in the greatest city in America right here with you. We love Richmond, Virginia.
Mayor Jones, you're doing a great job. What a wonderful time to be a Richmonder.
Cool cities do cool things.
Vibrant, eclectic, diverse, cool, resurgent, and unstoppable. Richmond isn't just a city on the move, it's a juggernaut of creativity and determination. It's a melting pot of entrepreneurs, mom and pops, Fortune 500s, families, students, chefs, artists, and outdoor enthusiasts. You can feel it in the air. Richmond has a new vibe. That new vibe, it's partly fueled by an arts and culture scene that is exploding. That explosion has been invigorated by a dedicated arts and cultural district and innovative loan and grant programs pushed by Mayor Dwight C. Jones.
It was my desire to establish such a fund of $2 million, which would be available to stimulate revitalization for Richmond's neighborhoods and promote permanent job creation for low and moderate income residents by helping to bridge the credit gap by providing these funds.
We know that culture and arts is a catalyst for economic development, and to that end, my administration has worked to assist in making this happen. To date, we have provided $615,000 in revolving loan funding for this district. This investment has leveraged $6.1 million of private investment in the city.
Richmond's new vibe has new businesses coming and neighborhood businesses blossoming, many with the help of economic development programs, incentives, loans, and grants. And with that public investment, millions of dollars in private investment have been leveraged and thousands of jobs have been created.
We're happy that you took advantage of our CARE program. The CARE program is a part of our economic development initiative to revitalize neighborhoods and to encourage businesses such as this. Hundreds of building permits have been issued within the last several weeks that are eligible for rebates from the city. $43 million of building investment has gone into the district properties. 300 new units of housing are complete or under construction at an average size of 800 square feet. And more than 100,000 square feet of commercial space is complete or under construction. That's pretty good, isn't it?
And so this neighborhood is now drawing Fortune 500 companies, but it's also drawing small businesses. And we come today to celebrate, not only can the big shots be on Hull Street, but also the Hull Street Mini Mart can be here, mall can be here.
And I'm very proud to tell you that from 2009 to 2014, we have spent $87.8 million with minority businesses. Now that's a record.
The great thing about a vibe is that it flows out beyond our city limits. It intrigues outsiders and brings them in to experience it themselves. Whether it's to see a concert, bone up on history, attend one of the city's yearly festivals, eat where Daniel Day-Lewis ate while filming Lincoln, watch the Redskins play, or the Patriots, or the Texans, or to see a few international cyclists scoot through town, Richmond has it all and much, much more.
And for all these reasons and more, I'm happy to announce today the creation of my tourism commission. I'm charging the commission to look at three major things. First, we want to look at how to manage the tourist experience in Richmond. Secondly, we want to look at how to expand and enhance the assets and support the attractions that we have in Richmond. And third, we want to learn how to market Richmond in such a way that we always have wonderful packed weekends like we had last weekend here in the city.
We have a bold and exciting plan to put Richmond on the map with one of the most state-of-the-art NFL training camp facilities in the entire country.
And the first thing that comes to my mind is why not Richmond? Because we have it all here in this city. We have everything that any person who is interested in history, interested in culture, would want to know or to find out.
And those cyclists? After a winning bid and years of planning, hundreds of thousands of people came to watch them emerge on RVA.
We are here today to rejoice and to celebrate in the fact that the UCI World Races will be in Richmond in 2015. Aren't you excited about that?
9 days that I really think has changed the trajectory of our city's understanding of who we are and what we can accomplish, and change the trajectory of the kinds of monumental feats we can take on when we all work together. This was a tremendous feat, and we're very, very pleased.
And the vibe flows right down 95, where Main Street Station sits as a beacon to everyone passing. The soon-to-be official Virginia Welcome and Travel Center is undergoing an extensive renovation of the train shed, and once complete, will welcome tourists from near and far.
This project overall, three phases, head house, clock tower, first phase, that's completed across the street, second phase, and third phase is the train station, train shed rehabilitation. Overall, $100 million. The train shed is 100,000 square feet.
We've been working on the Main Street Station project for many years, and now we are getting to a point where you can actually see some of the developing progress that we're making on getting the station open.
This vibe that runs through Richmond, this feeling of energy and hope, it brings with it opportunity. And the Mayor's Office of Community Wealth Building, newly minted as a permanent city department, wants to make sure that everyone has a chance. Since its original inception in 2011 as the Anti-Poverty Commission, this organization's mandate has been to tackle the barriers that residents have in fulfilling their potential.
We're introducing something genuinely new into Richmond government, a mechanism for ensuring that poverty stays at the top of the agenda.
The number one recommendation of our poverty task force was this workforce innovation notion. And we are able to stand where we stood a couple of months ago as we began this work, and now it is completed.
And I'm very pleased this afternoon to name Professor Thad Williamson as the first director of the Mayor's Office of Community Welfare.
And now that the ball is rolling, the sky is the limit. The Office of Community Wealth Building has forged partnerships across the city and is providing services to young and old.
And so what we're doing with this program this year, besides starting to expand at scale, is being sure that we're looking at the individual trying to get a job in a holistic situation that looks at the entire family situation, identifies all the needs.
And a highlight of our budget is a $425,000 investment in RVA Future.
The idea being that there are students right now who could do more, accomplish more, and here's a critical point in their life that a little bit of guidance could affect their earning power and their quality of life in the next 50 years.
In addition to training and education, transportation can be a very real barrier to success. And for several years, the city and GRTC have been planning and gearing up for Broad Street Rapid Transit. The pulse is coming, and it's going to be a game changer.
Because this means that all of our work is not in vain, but we're going to change things in this city and make jobs available to those who need to get to those jobs. And that's why we're here today, because we recognize the importance of making sure that people have the opportunity to be a part of a multimodal community, to have the opportunity to get to point A from point B.
Certainly having access to transportation is critical for us as a community. As we continue to grow and expand the opportunities that we see within our boundaries, but also how we extend ourselves and look for opportunities when it comes to jobs and other kinds of services.
And we certainly want people to be able to see, and we want our city to feel the vitality of the Broad Street corridor.
The excitement, the changing vibe of Richmond reaches all the way down to our youth as students file into four new schools and a brand new pre-K, all under the leadership of Mayor Jones.
We want to welcome the students to the new Huguenot High School, and we began this process in 2012, and today we're very proud to welcome these students to this new state-of-the-art high school. This building, I believe, is a game changer for this neighborhood. And one of the things that I wanted to do when I became mayor was to make sure that we were serving the entire city.
And schools aren't the only thing that's new around the city. Richmond shines under new construction, renovations, and infrastructure improvements.
This new state-of-the-art fire station replaces a building that was 100 years old. And so this is a replacement that is long overdue.
We've invested about $11 million in libraries during my administration, $1 million projects here at the main library, and we're very excited about that.
And as you look around the city, you'll see that we're moving toward a robust network of bikeways, the proposed Franklin to Main cycle track, the Cannon Creek Greenway, and we're really excited about the Virginia Capitol Trail,
including extensive work at the city's Central Park, the James River.
This is a wonderful day for all of us here, particularly all of us who are concerned about conservation. It is a wonderful day for us to appreciate the natural, God-given gifts that we are the stewards of, and to take a look at how we have handled it and how we will handle it in the future. And my 2013 budget also has included in it the beginnings of accessibility for the river, so that we can get families and people not just to look at the river, but to get right down to where they can touch the river. We've announced plans for improvements to the port of Richmond. We've announced plans for the Low Line, our project with CXS and Capitol Trees. Work is being done on the intermediate terminal.
And with the completion of the new T. Tyler Potterfield Memorial Bridge, an integral part of the James River Master Plan, anticipated in the fall of 2016, access to the river will be unprecedented, north and south.
And one of those linkages is, how do we get to the river? So when I came in 2011, the city had just adopted, in 2 years, the downtown plan. The mayor said, we want to engage the water. So the first project out of the gate we've talked about is the T. Tyler Potterfield Memorial Bridge, to make that direct connection for a pedestrian and bicycle use from the north bank of the river to the south bank of the river.
Richmond's new vibe is spreading, and our hometown is known throughout the country for things us locals have always known. Richmond's home to the best parks, businesses, chefs, and restaurants, home to short drives and happy people, home to tattoos, street art, and some of the best trails anywhere. This new vibe, everyone feels it, and it pushes Richmond to continue the momentum. And if you think it can't get any better, the Jones administration isn't slowing down. Join in for another year of building the best Richmond. Please welcome Mayor Dwight C. Jones.
Thank you, and good evening, everyone. It's a delight to be here tonight, and each year I've been so grateful for this opportunity to pause and reflect on the things that we've accomplished together. And this year is a special time because we can reflect upon what we've done during the last 7 years, leading into this final year of our two terms together. I want to thank you all for being here this evening, and because this is my last State of the City speech, I'm going to take just do what I want to do. So let me begin by thanking our youth mayor, Khadijah Baker. She did a great job. Delegate McQuinn, thank you so much. I want to also recognize the members of our city council who are here tonight, and I want you to just hold your applause until I recognize all of them. But the president of city council, Michelle Mosby, stand up, Michelle, and Kathy Graziano and Dr. Newbill and Ellen Robertson, Charles Samuels, and Reva Trammell. Let's give them all a round of applause. We thank them so much for all they've done and for the opportunity to work with them during these years. Also from the school board tonight, Jeff Bourne, the chairman of the school board, is here. I believe he's the only person, but we're delighted that you're here. Who else? Mamie Taylor. All right. Okay. Thank you so much for being here tonight. And allow me to just take a moment to thank some of the people who have worked so hard with me across the years. My staff, Dr. Cheryl Ivy Green, my senior assistant, Tammy Hawley, who's our press secretary. Cheryl and Tammy have been with me for over 7 years, and you really have done a tremendous job. Grant Neely, my chief of staff, and Selena Cuffey Glenn, and all of the DCAOs. Won't you stand, Selena, and your DCAOs, and all of the senior team? They're all on the front row there. Everybody stand up there. Give them a big round of applause. And I want to give a big shout out to the press office for the tremendous support, all of the events that you saw cataloged in those videos, but especially for the State of the City. It takes a lot to put this together. And so kudos to Tammy and her staff, Mike Wallace, Shelby Crouch, Tyler Hill, and Raymond Dock. Thank you so much. And I understand that the Mayor's Youth Academy is here somewhere. Where are they? Stand up. Look at. I am so proud of the Mayor's Youth Academy, and they make me proud wherever we go, and I'm so grateful for the opportunity to have begun that program. Also, I see many clergymen who are here. We thank you so much for coming. And my family, they have really stuck with me for these 7 years. Hadn't been easy, but they've been right there. So thank you so much for being here tonight. And so tonight we're here to talk about the state of the city. And I want to say, with respect to the recent weather, bravo to the city crews who were in neighborhoods in less than 24 hours after the last snowflake fell. The city mounted an impressive response to the storm. Actually, this was not a storm, it was a blizzard. And I just want to say thank you to the hardworking, dedicated city employees for their efforts. I don't plan to keep you long tonight, even though we have 7 years of accomplishments to go over, that we could go over. But I want to focus more on the direction that we're going in, and I want to take a little time to talk about where we are today, because it's important and we should acknowledge our achievements even as we look to the future. 7 years ago, we came into office at a time of economic distress, the worst global recession in decades, the most severe financial crisis since the Great Depression. And when I took office, I said we would position the city for economic growth, that we'd be on the ready when the economy turned. And we've done just that. I said that we would not tax our way out of the economic challenges nor cut our way out, but I said we would implement new pro-growth strategies that would allow us to weather the storm and put us on a stronger, more sustainable path. That meant two things. We had to grow our economy, and we had to reduce our poverty levels. And that's what we need to talk about tonight and throughout this year. We've had our challenges, however, our moments of success and triumph cannot be forgotten. But we should celebrate tonight the things we've been able to accomplish and build upon those things as we move into our amazing future. I love Richmond, and my commitment has always been to protect her well-being and the well-being of each and every resident over the last 7 years that I've served as mayor. Today, the city has never been more attractive for investment, and our brand has never been stronger. So many exciting new changes have brought RVA together during this time. A few years back, we didn't even call it RVA. Today, you see the RVA brand proudly displayed on cars from Fredericksburg to Petersburg. And it's especially nice to see them also in Henrico and Chesterfield. There was a time when people said crime will always hold Richmond back. People said you need a bigger jail in order to make Richmond safe. But we rejected that idea. We threw out the ugly notion that safe communities depend on more jail cells and bigger locks. Instead, we launched innovative alternatives to incarceration and new programs that have earned national attention, programs that have touched the hearts of people and changed lives. We have a smart, aggressive team of people like Sheriff C.T. Woody, who I forgot to recognize, who's here tonight. Our Commonwealth's Attorney Mike Herring and our Police Chief Al Durham. You got the whole police force to clap for you. And the results speak for themselves. Today, violent crime is at its lowest rate in 45 years, down 30% since 2009. And make no mistake about it, if you lived in Richmond in the 1990s, you know just how important this is. This turnaround is driving our economic resurgence. And again, the numbers tell the truth. For decades, the city's population steadily went down, declined, as middle-class people quietly slipped away, both black and white. But today, we've reversed that trend. And today, people are moving into Richmond, not out of Richmond. And at 214,000, our estimated population is higher than it's been in the last 30 years. And as a result of that, we have one of the hottest housing markets in the country. And you might have heard that on all of the national news outlets last week. Businesses are moving into our downtown, and our urban center is more vibrant and more alive than ever before in our lifetimes. Our restaurant scene is absolutely amazing. It's on fire. National Geographic has called Richmond a top foodie destination, thanks in part to projects in the city, projects that the city has backed and supported, like Rappahannock, Blue Bee Cider, and Hardywood, and Stone, and many, many others. Right here in the heart of downtown, our facade improvement program, our lending programs, and our micro grants have infused areas like Gray Street with new life and vigor, advancing restaurants such as Pasture and the new Julep's location. We've supported Pops on Gray Street and Visual Chefs and 93 Octane.
This very theater, the Sarah Bell and Neil November Theater, has undergone a beautiful restoration, making it a central part of our cultural renaissance. And lest anyone say that we're playing favorites, we've invested in a coffee shop and a furniture shop on Broad Street, even though those businesses consistently oppose every important downtown revitalization project. And we did it because the city's success depends on everybody's success, even those who criticize us. A few blocks away, we helped bring the historic Hippodrome back to life. On Lee Street, we grew tired of talking and waiting for something to happen with the old armory that sat dark and abandoned for so long. So we took action. And in just a few weeks, that historic national landmark will become the new home of the Black History Museum. And on Broad Street, we helped find a way to bring the long-abandoned CFB building back to life after sitting idle for many, many years. And later this year, that beautiful Art Deco building at the corner of 2nd and Broad will be full of life, housing growing populations of millennials and urban dwellers. Now, a moment ago, you saw the video about Richmond Speaks and our progress toward appropriately developing Lumpkin's Jail in Richmond fashion. It's been a long, emotional, and contentious process, but as Dolores McQuinn mentioned, we now have $19 million available to better tell Richmond's story. And that's up from zero when I took office, and it matters because we're not just bringing light into dark buildings, we're also shining light into the city's dark past. And I want to thank Cynthia Newbill for being such a strong proponent of this. Today, we're telling the story of the men and women who built this city and this nation. Today, we're telling the story of the men and women who built this city and nation, and we're honoring the memory of those forgotten souls who have been lost to history. Later this year, we're going to erect a monument to Maggie Lena Walker. And we're going to honor her in the center of our commercial corridor. We've made it a priority, and it's possible because of the hard work of many people in the city, but I have to mention tonight Melvin Jones. Mr. Jones had unwavering faith, and his voice was unwavering about the importance of this project, and he helped to catapult us to where we are today. Our downtown is flourishing in so many ways, and we're sitting right here in the middle of what is now known as the Arts District, something else that was established during our time in office. And we were told at one time that it was too complicated, but we reached an agreement and we got it done. Today, our arts district is comprised of galleries and cultural institutions, shops and hotels, restaurants and more, an intentional effort on our part because we recognize the importance of the tourism dollar to our future, accounting for more than $600 million annually. Investment in our arts district just in FY15 alone amounts to $72.9 million based on permits that we issued. To support our vision, we hired the city's first tourism coordinator. We established the city's first pedestrian bicycles and trails coordinator, the city's first public arts coordinator, the city's first sustainability coordinator, and we're dramatically upgrading the waterfront. And I heard Mark talking about that on the video, with exciting projects like the Potterfield Bridge and the intermediate terminal improvements. And all of these things are increasing our brand, making our city more friendly for walkers, but also for bikers. And by far the biggest event we took on that has had impact on tourism draw and will have impact for many years was the UCI Road World Championships, something else people said we could not succeed with. The numbers tell the story, though. 650,000 spectators. 170 million dollars in economic impact for the Commonwealth. It brought visitors from 34 states and 24 countries generated media coverage about Richmond all over the world. This wasn't just a bike race. And if you missed it, you missed the best party we've ever thrown. And for Richmond, it's proven that we're not only able to conceive big things, but we're able to achieve big things. And similarly, we kept telling people that the Redskins training camp is about more than football. With respect to that project deal, development in the East End was important to us and was successfully leveraged, and we had underutilized land on Lee Street behind the Science Museum forever. And now we've got an NFL team that visits every year and that has attracted two other NFL teams to our town for a visit. We've got a beautiful state-of-the-art football training facility that is utilized throughout the year for other purposes, and regardless of whether you are a fan of this project or not, the fact remains that the project resulted in $40 million worth of economic development for our city because of our partnership with Bon Secours. And as I talk to mayors around the country, let me tell you, any mayor would relish the kind of return on investment that we have received. At the beginning of my term, I spoke about getting tangible return on any investment we make. That is what was promised, and that is what we are achieving. In the East End, Fulton has been devoid of significant development and economic activity for decades. That area has been neglected and faced many broken promises, but we followed our economic development strategy and beat out over 300 other cities to attract Stone Brewing Company to our city. And not only to our city, but we attracted it to Fulton. And again, we beat the odds. And now we have 200,000 square feet of distribution space that will soon employ more than 200 people. The project is coming online not next year, but this year. And let's not overlook our recent agreement with the Virginia Port Authority for a long-term operating lease for the Richmond Port. This agreement is a game changer for the city of Richmond, our once underused port already booming into the new year. We've added four new shipping carriers to the six we had before. Council approved our lease proposal in the fall. And let me put that in perspective for you. That would be like going to the airport and adding four new international airlines in just a matter of months. Richmond is ascending to a key position in global trade because of what we are doing now. The port berth is being dredged, more and more shipping lines are connecting to us every day, and we're cutting the ribbon on a new harbor crane this coming Monday when we celebrate the long-term Richmond lease with our partners at the Port Authority. This partnership shows how we do business with people who do what they say they're going to do. The port is strong, it's a strong foundation for jobs and economic resurgence, and it's going to bring dividends to us for many, many years to come. These accomplishments, these successes, are the types of legacies or the types of things that legacies are built on. And for me, my legacy will not be determined by news articles or editorials or interviews. My legacy is the voice of the citizenry and in the faces of the people that I meet on the streets of Richmond every day, who stop me and thank me and let me know that we have made a difference in their lives. These are the people who understand that we've delivered seven balanced budgets during the time of economic downturn. These are the people that understand that we've paid our bills, that we didn't raise property taxes, that we didn't lay off or furlough employees when times got tough. These are the people who know that we built our cash reserve from $48 million to $80 million today. These are the people who know that we got six bond rating upgrades from Wall Street, even as we continue to work on our financial operations. So we proudly claim progress tonight. We've never claimed to be perfect, but we are proud of the progress that we've made. and the job that we've done. Truly. The state of Richmond is thriving. The progress we've made is rooted in focusing not only on one side of town, but the whole city. Not just the privileged few, but everybody. Our focus has been on people and community. We've become the first city in the nation to create a mayor's office on community wealth building. And just last month, we made that a permanent part of Richmond city government, which means that when I go, this project stays. The office is a catalyst bringing together the work of other city agencies and community organizations to address wealth inequality in Richmond. Under this effort, we have launched RVA Future to connect Richmond's public school graduates to college and eventually to scholarships. We jump-started plans for the 7.6-mile bus rapid transit line. We've laid the framework to invest $25 million from the United States Department of Transportation into creating a progressive and competitive transportation network, the first stage of a much-needed regional transportation system to connect people to jobs. This is an amazing funding opportunity to build a network that will address mobility concerns for our citizens who desperately need it. And friends, we've been working on this for years, and any delay will be costly for us as a city. Now is the right time for bus rapid transit. We're also charting the course for the creation of social enterprise opportunities linked to existing large employers. We want to build on assets, resources, and our current potential to provide jobs and build wealth so families and households can be successful, not just for a month or for a year, but for generations. And I believe that our successful future is largely rooted in utilizing our anchor institution, these large employers, in this way, as a source of local jobs, as economic engines that can invest in the local economy. For adults living in poverty, a job is the true way out. Expanded employment opportunities are exactly what a primary focus of our administration has been. Economic development is what it's all about. Did you know that recruiting one or more major employer capable of creating hundreds of jobs accessible to the underemployed here in Richmond was one of the top five recommendations of the Anti-Poverty Commission? That's exactly what we've done with Stone. Hundreds of jobs accessed by underemployed Richmond residents. And let's take a quick look at the Commission's other top recommendations. They said we should invest in workforce development targeted toward low-skilled and low-term unemployed, long-term unemployed, and underemployed residents. Well, we can check that off. Our workforce development initiative, and particularly our program to train welders, has been successfully developing skilled workers. We've been sure to integrate the training opportunities into real-life experience whenever possible. Participants in our welding program have built and installed bike racks all over the city. Our welding program alone has found opportunity with UCI bike races. They built and installed bike racks around the city as well as building the barricades for the racers when they came. And one of my proudest moments was seeing our welders in the program bring their families downtown to show off their work that supported the international event. Another recommendation was to develop an effective educational pipeline that prepares RPS students for either college or the workforce. Well, we can check that off as well. We talked about RVA Future a little bit earlier. We've opened all five, in all five of the schools, we've opened RVA Futures. Also, our technical training programs will become more robust. We're moving the welding program, expanding it now. We're going into auto repair. We were told to create a regional rapid transit system. Well, we can check that off because we're going to do BRT. This was a goal before we knew we'd win the $25 million grant from the United States Department of Transportation. Construction can begin this year for this 7.6-mile route. And finally, we were told to achieve the redevelopment of much of the Richmond City's public housing stock without involuntarily displacing residents, with the aim of weakening the concentration of poverty and improving the physical and social environment of public housing residents. We can check that off because our plans are advancing for public housing transformation in the city of Richmond. Ladies and gentlemen, Richmond is now growing by design and not by default. And before I leave that point, let me just also mention Councilwoman Ellen Robertson, because she's been such a driving force behind these initiatives. And it would be one thing if we were doing this in the dark, but other people are noticing what we are about. In the New York Times, the Washington Post, just yesterday I spoke about inclusive economic development at the Aspen Institute in Washington, D.C. Our city was recognized, the city of Richmond, because we now have a working model for inclusive economic development. People want to know how we did it, why we did it. The people want to know how they can do it. And one of the things I talked about yesterday was our BLIS program. It stands for Building Lives to Independence and Self-Sufficiency. This program provides family-based wraparound support services to assist working parents in getting ahead. This program is designed to address obstacles such as transportation and childcare. And you know, sometimes we get caught up and have an impression of the kind of people we're talking about when we talk about community wealth building. But let me just give you an idea that might change your mind. I want to tell you about one of our participants. She's a mother of 7 children. All of her children are well managed and very bright. Her eldest son has been on the honor roll at a Richmond school. Her eldest daughter has been a part of the mayor's youth academy. The daughter's a junior with a 3.67 GPA on a college track curriculum. That's so much better than I did. And the mother herself has an associate's degree in applied science and a medical records certificate from J. Sarge. She has 136 college credit hours to complete, but this family lives in Gilpin Court. And so this profile allows us to know that we have families that are in public housing and families that do not deserve to be there, families that need our assistance and our help. We don't want to leave them behind. Matter of fact, we don't want to leave anybody behind. And so we've got to continue our work to make the effects of poverty less punishing and to provide pathways to success. We've set the course. We can achieve the absolute reduction in the number of people living in poverty in our city and increase the number of adults working full-time jobs year-round. Staying on this course is the key for the city's healthy and successful future. That's the goal for our creating a permanent office of community wealth building. And let me thank every member of Richmond City Council tonight for joining in this vision and voting to codify this new department and this work. Thank you so much. So as I close, let me talk just a little bit about education. Education, of course, everybody knows that growing our economy and reducing our poverty hinges on strong, high-quality public schools. You know, I joined the Richmond School Board, Jeff, in 1979. And I've been working on educational issues for over 45 years. And since I've been mayor, we've focused on early childhood education. We've built 4 new schools, and each of those schools have community centers, including Richmond's first new high school in 40 years. We've established the RVA Future Program and supported new programs to support young people's out-of-school time. It's also why Public schools are now the largest portion of the city's budget next to public safety. We singularly spend more on public schools than anything else, more than economic development, highways, streets, and human services put together. And there's nothing wrong with this in the abstract. After all, there's nothing more important as a priority than advancing the education of our children. But we need to do more to ensure that we're getting quality for the dollars that we spend. We now spend more per student than nearly any other school division in Virginia. And while we celebrate the incremental improvements that have begun to tick up slightly, we have to acknowledge and be honest that our academic performance still ranks near the bottom. This is surely why Richmond hears calls for more money. But it's important to understand how school financing really works in the Commonwealth and what it means for the city of Richmond. We have two problems. First is how the state allocates its money. Public schools are funded with a mix of state money and local money, but the state sets the rules. Wealthy localities get more money, so they have less money from the state. Poor localities have less, so they get more money from the state, or so it should be. Because we're both rich and poor, it hurts our public schools. One part of our city is growing and thriving, but 26% of our people live in poverty. That's the highest rate in Central Virginia, and poverty is concentrated in Richmond because of policy decisions made generations ago, not by us. Today, this means that we receive less money from the state and we have higher costs than our suburban neighbors. The second problem is, during the recession, the state changed the school funding formula to give less money to localities. In fact, the Washington Post reported on Sunday that as the state's economy rebounded, many of the formulas stayed the same. According to a Richmond think tank, the result is that Richmond schools are being shortchanged by $800 million a year because of formulas that underestimate what it actually costs to educate a child. In short, the state stopped funding thousands of support positions and student services, leaving cities and counties to pick up the tab. Now, Governor McAuliffe has proposed in his two-year budget methods to try to address this problem, but fixing that is going to take time, and we're not sure that the General Assembly is going to support his proposal. In the meantime, regardless of how we get there, we still have a problem in Richmond, and residents of our city are demanding action. They want something to be done about it. Here are the numbers. Last year, RPS said we need $25 million in new money just to operate the schools. City Council cut other budget line items and gave $9 million in new money to RPS. This year, on top of that, RPS says it needs another $26 million in new money just to operate the schools that we have now. In addition, RPS is advancing a building plan that will cost upwards of $600 million. Phase one alone costs nearly $170 million. The annual debt service alone on that would cost roughly $17 million for a total of $43 million in new money every year into the future. So Richmonders need to have a serious conversation about the resources we have and the tax levels we're able to bear. We've all seen this image, but we probably won't see an image like this. And that's what we need to talk about tonight. Tonight, we need to talk about the fact that the bottom line is that the money has got to come from somewhere. And we have to broaden the conversation because there are just a few options. We can grow our economy to generate new revenue, but this is going to take time. And the division says that we want to do something immediately. We can cut funding on other services and shift the money to schools, but City Council already did this last year. And I'm not in favor of significantly diverting operating funds or raiding our financial reserves. The third thing is that we can raise taxes. These are serious decisions that should not be made by me in my office or by the council alone in chambers. While we already have the highest real estate taxes in the area, public sentiment appears to be growing for major new investments in public schools. We recognize that. But preliminary estimates suggest that RPS needs could cost over 15 cents increase in our real estate taxes in order to fund these proposals. Such an increase is a major, major decision, and one that the public should be deeply involved in. Therefore, my plan is to explore with the members of City Council the idea of an advisory referendum on the November ballot to determine whether the public wishes to raise taxes, and if so, by how much. We have to consider that while public schools are critical, we also have other priorities. So I believe we should also include questions such as what we should do about infrastructure needs. That way, the citizens will know what our residents expect, and residents will be clear about the impact on other services as a result of spending decisions made. If it is the will of people to significantly raise taxes, then they will have a chance to directly indicate that. If they prefer to drastically cut services, to give up leaf collection, to cut City Hall hours, so forth and so on, then we'll know that as well. With this approach together, we will be able to determine exactly what course Richmonders would like for us to take to address our future needs. This is very important, and the conversation has got to be a conversation that does not just take place at City Hall. It's got to be a conversation that includes the entire city of Richmond. Regardless of the outcome of that conversation right now, we have an obligation to continue to build our city, to grow our city, and to work to produce economic development opportunities that will generate the revenues we need to meet our needs. Our city is strong, and we're headed to a horizon that is better than it has ever been. But we've got to make the prudent choices and not miss the rare opportunities that we have. The decision we make about Boulevard development is one of the most important development decisions that we will have as it relates to economic and community renewal. This decision here will have the greatest financial impact on the direction of our city's future. This decision has everything to do with how we're going to bring more visitors, how we're going to create more jobs, how we're going to remain competitive and attractive. We must build the economy of the future. For a landlocked city to have its best 60 acres not reaching full market potential against the backdrop of the city's many needs, that would certainly be a tragedy. And then for us to be criticized for daring to pursue the financial highest and best use of this land is absolutely absurd. Right now, we have a site that generates no more than $400,000 in total tax revenue to the city. We could have a site that generates 20 times more than that if we make the right decision. It's our job to position the city to provide greater impact for its citizens. And it is my hope that we'll make the right decisions together. We want to hear every voice, and we will not back down from making the hard choices. As for me and my administration, our work has been good. We've set a clear course, and we can secure an even brighter future. And even as our time begins to wind down, we know that our work is not done. We've got some unfinished business, and we won't be slowing down a bit over these coming months. We'll be working up to the last day because we've come too far to turn around now. Make no mistake, we're going to make every possible day count. Be clear, Richmond, that our best days are not behind us, but our best days are in front of us. Thank you so much for coming out to hear this address tonight. Thank you.